So let's start with basically what we mean by media access protocols. So normally when we refer to links, we can look at links as belonging to two different types. One is we can say we have point-to-point links, and then we can talk about broadcast or shared wire or media. Whenever you have a shared wire or medium, we talk about broadcast links. You're familiar with both these things. Example of point-to-point link is when you have, for instance, a dial-up access. When we do a dial-up access, what do we typically do? You have a dedicated connection from your machine to the network that you're connecting to. So you have a point-to-point or for dial-up access link. And this uses actually a protocol called the point-to-point protocol. It's called as a PPP protocol. You can look up for details on this later. So similarly, a point-to-point link you will see is also used between Ethernet switch and host. For instance, if you have an Ethernet switch at home that you're configuring, your machine would be connected. In order to do the configuration, you'll find that you're doing the configuration using the point-to-point protocol. You'll find that there's a protocol called PPPoE or something like that that you use when you actually do the configuration. So we talk about point-to-point protocols, which are basically between two points, two nodes connected to each other by means of a link. And so there is no question of sharing the link because there are only two nodes. One transmits, the other receives. This transmits, the other one receives. So there's no, they have the link dedicated to themselves for both of them to do the transmission. And obviously, we know that when both of them can transmit and receive at the same time, we refer to that as a full duplex link. Otherwise, we talk about simplex links. In simplex, there's only a transfer can take place only in one direction. Then we talk about half duplex, where they can actually transmit in both directions, but only one at a time. Right? So those are the possibilities we have with respect to point-to-point links in general. But the access problem comes about only when we have a broadcast link. That is, when you have a shared wire or a medium, then you have multiple nodes which need to connect to that. So how do they connect to that? So we talk about using a... Now, this happens in two places in which we are very familiar with. One is the traditional Ethernet. The Ethernet network that we use. The Ethernet network, you will see, is one of the common networks that we use in most of our LANs. Similarly, in the wireless LAN, 802.11 wireless LAN. I'm giving you these two examples because these are two examples that you're actually using every day. There are, of course, other examples of broadcast media where, again, the media is shared. It could be a wire which is shared, or it could be the wireless media which is shared. Which is why I said it's a shared wire or medium. For instance, if you talk about a wireless LAN, it's the media that is being shared. In the case of an Ethernet, you have a wire. That same wire is used by multiple nodes to transmit data. So there is a wire which is shared. Or in general, we can say it's a media which is shared, because wire also, after all, is some kind of a media, physical media, right? So whenever you have a media that needs to be shared by multiple people, we need to look at how the access can be shared by them. So that is what we need to look at. So when we talk about multiple access protocols, basically what is it that we have? We have a single shared broadcast channel, and there are two or more simultaneous transmissions by nodes. And whenever you have two or more simultaneous transmissions by nodes, what we will end up with is interference. If I have this, obviously it means that I should not have two or more simultaneous transmissions by nodes, which can cause an interference. But if you can allow two or more nodes to simultaneously transmit without an interference, then it is fine. So either we have to devise techniques which will allow two or more nodes to simultaneously transmit without any interference. That is one way of doing it. Or we have to come up with a technique to make sure that not more than one person will transmit at any given point of time. So we have to look at these two. There are two ways to handle this problem. We know that two people transmit at the same time, there will be some interference. Either you come up with a technique such that no interference will occur. You have come up with some indigenous technique. Right? Either you do that, or you make sure that two of them will never transmit at the same time. So that is what media access protocols typically do. Okay. So let's look at how that is done. Okay. Most of these multiple access protocols, so we have some kind of protocols that are used by most of the networks, which allow this sharing to be done. And how does this sharing normally occur? I mean, what kind of algorithms are used for the sharing? If you look at that, you'll find that most of these cases, it's some kind of a distributed algorithm. And what this distributed algorithm does is, it determines how the nodes will share the channel. That is, determine when a node can transmit. And why do we say it's a distributed algorithm? Because all the nodes which are part of it normally participate in this algorithm. Since all of them participate, they collectively decide who is going to transmit at any given point of time. Okay, that is how the decision of who is going to transmit is done. And what is interesting about most of these multiple access protocols is that communication about the channel sharing must use the channel itself. That is, the communication about the channel sharing, how is it that the channel is to be shared, any decision that is to be taken about the sharing should also be done using that same channel. There is no out-of-band communication which is normally available. Normally, we talk about in-band and out-of-band. So what we mean by these two terms is that when you say in-band, the same channel which is used for actually transferring the data will be used for communication, either control information as well. That is the kind of situation we have now. Because we're talking about a broadcast channel. It's a single channel shared by everybody. It's a shared media. So whatever control information you're sending is also shared, is also to be sent only using the same channel. So we say that communication about the channel sharing must also use the channel itself. So we need to have a mechanism for incorporating that. So that is what we need to. So in general, let's say, let's try to find out what is it that we expect from an ideal multiple access protocol. So we've looked at what we need in terms of multiple nodes to share access to a media. So what would an ideal multiple access protocol typically be? I mean, what are the requirements for an ideal protocol? So if you look at that, so let's say I have a broadcast channel of rate r bits per second. Okay, that is the rate of the channel, that's the capacity of the channel, let's say. So what is it that I want? One of the first requirements I would have is, when one node wants to transmit, it can send at rate r. What we mean by this is, if nobody else is transmitting, only one node is transmitting, then ideal situation is that it can use the full bandwidth of the channel which is available. So that's what we mean by saying that when one node wants to transmit, it can send at a rate of r bits per second. Okay. Now, if more than one node, or let's say m nodes want to transmit, when m nodes want to transmit, each can send at an average rate of r by m. This is an ideal situation, right? If there are more people sharing it, we would like the bandwidth to be divided equally among them. So there are m nodes, total bandwidth is r. So if m nodes are transmitting at the same time, there is more than one node, right? If m nodes are transmitting at the same time, we would like that each of them get an average bandwidth of r by m. That is our next, that would be the next ideal situation. Third thing is, we would like this to be fully decentralized. What we mean by this is, there should be no special node, no central node kind of a thing, which will be used to coordinate the transmissions. Okay? And we typically would like to have no synchronization of clocks, because everything happens, if it happens in a distributed manner, with minimal coordination between, with minimal centralized coordination, it will be desirable. And of course, the fourth thing is, all these things, we would like the whole thing to be simple protocol, so that it becomes easier to implement it, and it is cost effective when you implement something like this. Okay, so these are typically the ideal characteristics that you would expect of any multiple access protocol. Now you look at other multiple access protocols and see how much of this ideal requirements are met by many of these protocols. Okay, so broadly we can look at the multiple access protocols, MAC protocols as we refer to them, these protocols into two categories. Okay, one is called as channel partitioning kind of protocols, and the other are random access protocols. Okay. So what we mean by channel partitioning is that you have the full broadcast channel, but the channel is divided into into smaller pieces. Okay. So you divide the channel into smaller pieces. And how do we do this division? It can be done based on many parameters. You could divide it based on time. You could divide it based on some slots or time slots. You can divide it based on frequency. You can divide it based on some kind of a code. We'll see how exactly these things are done. And what we mean, and then what do? Each of these small pieces, we allocate it or dedicate it to a node for exclusive use. So that is, this is one example of how the media can be shared. You have the full media, the full capacity of the media, divided into small pieces, and allocate each piece to each node for doing its transmission. So you're allowing all of them to share the media. This is one option that we have. The second option is a random access kind of a protocol. Here what we do is, we don't divide the channel. So which means that the channel is free, the entire channel is available for everybody to transmit. In which case, what could actually happen is, if two people try to transmit at the same time, collisions will occur. So what do you mean by collision? Collision is a case where two channels transmit, their data will collide. So naturally, you cannot make sense out of what is being transmitted. So you're not dividing the channel. You allow more than one node to transmit and collisions will occur. But if a collision occurs, what do we do when a collision occurs? We will try to see how you can recover from those collisions. So if you do not recover from the collisions, then obviously what will happen is that your data will be lost. So that is not a desirable situation. So we will try to see how these protocols actually are implemented. Now look at what is the difference between these two. In channel partitioning, you are actually dividing the channel and allocating it, the smaller pieces, to different nodes for data transfer. So what will happen if a node does not use that particular slot or particular frequency, then you will find that that particular resource is wasted. Whereas in random access, you can make sure that whoever wants to transmit, they will get the full use of the channel. So that's the difference that you have between these two, between channel partitioning and random access. But the downside of random access is that you will have collisions, and because of collision, again, some bandwidth will be lost. So we will have to always look at a trade-off between what is gained and what is lost in both the protocols, and come up with, based on our requirement, which is the one that we need. Okay. So let's look at the channel partitioning algorithms first. These are very simple. The ideas used are very, very simple protocols. As I said, you can do this division based on either time or frequency to start with. These are very easy to understand. So what do you mean by time division multiplexing? The entire channel, the transmission time, if you look at, is just divided into n time slots. Okay, I have n nodes that need to transmit. I divide the time into n time slots. So when I say n time slots, one slot is given per user. Okay, and you allow them to transmit. The problem with this case is that it can be very inefficient with low duty cycle users and at light load. That is, when the load on the entire channel is light. Okay, so what will happen then is that, or if you have a low duty cycle, what do you mean by duty cycle? Duty cycle is the time for which it transmits over the entire time that is available to it. That is, it is not transmitting the entire time that is allotted to it. You are allocating some time to it, but it doesn't really transmit for that full duration. In which case, it is using that, since it has been allocated to it, nobody else can transmit at that time. And if nobody else can transmit at that time, naturally that resource gets wasted. So that is not a very desirable situation. That is one of the drawbacks of the time division multiplexing mechanism. The other is the frequency division multiplexing. As it here, we divide it based on frequency. That is, the entire frequency band that you have is divided into smaller bands, and each small band is allocated for a channel to transmit data. So let's look at what happens a little bit more in the TDMA, that is a time division multiple access mechanism. Okay, in a time division multiple access, as I said, you are dividing it into slots, and this access to channel happens in rounds. That is, if I have n slots, for instance, if you look at this figure, let's say you have a frame here. Okay, if you have a frame here, and this frame, let's assume that now I've got, say, 6 slots in this. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 slots are there. This 6 slot frame will get repeated once this time frame is over. This frame, this entire frame, has been divided into 6 slots, and one slot is dedicated for each channel to transmit. This is for slot 1, is for node 1, slot 2 is for node 2, and so on. And once that 6 slots are over, again the same frame will repeat. So you can see when 1 gets to transmit. 1 gets to transmit in its slot over here, then 1 will get a chance only at this particular point of time. Okay, so look at this example here. So you can see what is shown here. You can see that 1, 3 and 4 are shaded, meaning that there is some transmission that is happening in those slots. But you can see that 2, 5 and 6 are idle. What do we mean by this? This means that 2, 5 and 6 are actually not transmitting. Since they are not transmitting, half the bandwidth that you have in this particular channel is wasted. And look at the disadvantage of the situation. 1 actually has data, may have data to transmit, and there is also a free slot available, but 1 cannot use that slot because the channel has already been allocated only for 2, 5 and 6. If 2, 5 and 6 don't use it, nobody else can use that channel. That is the problem with this kind of a TDMA kind of mechanism. Okay. So this is something which is used in many standard scenarios. Okay, so this is the and normally what we do is the length of the slot. There are various things which will affect the efficiency of the protocol. What should be the length of the slot? So length of the slot normally is fixed to the packet transmission time. That is, if you say that each of them will transmit one packet or one frame during each round, so you fix the slot time such that it is equal to the transmission time of one packet. So and then all of them obviously agree on this time, and then they keep transmitting at the correct rate. Of course, this will require clock synchronization, because some kind of synchronization will be required, because each of them have to insert their data at exactly the same time. And the receiver, which is expecting to receive data from node 1 or node 3 or node 4, should exactly lock on to that particular time slot and pick up the data from there. So that is how the TDMA protocol will work. Okay. Next, if we look at the FDMA protocol, there is a frequency division based multiple access protocol. Here, as I said, the channel spectrum, what do you mean by spectrum? The entire frequency bandwidth that you have. That is divided into multiple frequency bands. A typical example for this is our FM transmission that you have. So you know that you have your 88 megahertz to whatever 108 megahertz transmissions available for you. If you take your radio, FM radio transmission, in that you find that different channels are allocated for different transmissions. What Radio Mirchi has a particular band it uses, FM Gold uses a particular band of frequencies. So you divide it into frequency bands, and all of them simultaneously access the channel, right? They have the complete access to the channel, but only in that particular frequency band. So that's this example. So each station is assigned a fixed frequency band, and here again, if there is an unused transmission time in a particular frequency band, then that goes idle. For instance, if, say Gold, FM Gold or whatever, that station does not have a transmission between 11 p.m. and, say, 6 a.m. in the morning or something like that. That, for that duration, nobody else can use that particular frequency band. It goes, it has been dedicated to that particular channel. So something very similar. So the same thing we are looking at with multiple nodes in a network, and the nodes actually sharing the different frequency, the bandwidth that's available in terms of frequency. So if a particular node does not transmit data, you'll find that that particular bandwidth is wasted. So for example, the same, if I look at the same 6 station LAN, if 1, 3 and 4 have a packet, then and 2, 5 and 6 do not have any packets to transmit, then the frequency bands 2, 5 and 6 would be idle. Okay, this is a disadvantage of the frequency division multiple access protocol. That is, you will see that in both these places, that is both time division and frequency division, where you are allocating, that is partitioning the channel, the moment you say I am partitioning something and you dedicate the available resource to that particular node, and if that node does not use it, then it becomes, then the capacity is wasted. So that's a problem with these channel partitioning mechanisms. Okay, another example of the channel partitioning mechanism is the code division multiple access, which is CDMA. Now, I'm sure all of you are familiar with this term CDMA. CDMA, you're all talking about CDMA cell phones and so on. So what is a CDMA actually? It basically refers to a multiple access mechanism. Okay, here what is done is, this is a very interesting mechanism in the sense that the entire frequency band, that the entire bandwidth that you have is available for everybody to transmit data, and they all transmit data simultaneously. Okay, but we still make sure that no interference occurs. How is that done? Basically what we do is each station is given a unique code that it uses, and these codes are chosen such that the codes are orthogonal to one another. So what do you mean by something being orthogonal to another one? When you say orthogonal, typically if you look at it as two vectors and we say two vectors are orthogonal to one another, the dot product of the two vectors will be zero, right? A dot B will be zero if the two vectors are orthogonal to one another. So similarly, here if I have n different users, I assign n codes to them such that these n codes are mutually orthogonal to one another. So, and I still have, and each of them, whenever they transmit data, they will use that unique code to transmit the data. That is, the data that they have is coded into this unique code pattern and it is transmitted. Multiple codes go in at the same time. They are all transmitted at the same time. But because the codes are orthogonal to one another, you can recover each code separately from the composite signal that is being sent. That is the beauty of the CDMA protocol. Okay? That is, what is interesting here is all users actually are sharing the same frequency. But you, each user has his own chipping sequence. This code that I talked about is normally referred to as a chipping code. Okay, so we say it has a chipping sequence to encode the data. So now the advantage is that multiple users can coexist and transmit data simultaneously with minimal interference. Of course, the bottom line for that is that the codes have to be orthogonal. So the work here, or the interesting part of this, is in designing such codes such that you are able to identify these orthogonal codes. Now remember that when you have, so it's very, the idea is actually very simple. Suppose I have a node, station A using a code A, and a node B using a code, let's say, which is represented by a vector B. Now what is it that you have when you have A and B simultaneously transmitting to each other? Let's say you have A plus B that is being transmitted. Now if I do a dot product of A plus B with A, you will get A dot A plus A dot B, right? Now what happens with, let me see, maybe I'll just go back to the, let me see, where is the, one second, right, okay, so the example I'm trying to talk about is, I have a vector A, and then a vector B. Okay, assume that this is some code. This could be some 0, 1, 1, 0. This can be some other pattern. Okay, say 1, 0, 0, 1, whatever. Okay, I'm just taking some arbitrary pattern. I'm taking some arbitrary pattern. But now let's look at this. I have A and B, both are being transmitted. So if I take A, dot product of A with A dot A plus B, what is it that I will get? I will get A dot A plus A dot B. Remember, we have chosen the code such that they are orthogonal to one another. So now what happens? A dot B will go to 0, right? And A dot A will give me A. So though A and B are simultaneously transmitting data, the moment I do a dot product of this sequence with the desired sequence, let's say I'm looking to see if there is any transmission by A in it, all I do is I do a dot product of this final sum that I have, the actual signal that's being transmitted, which consists of component of A as well as the component of B. I do a dot product of that with A, and you see that you can actually recover A alone separately. Similarly, if I do B dot A plus B. What will I get back? I will naturally get back B dot A will go to 0. So, I'll get B dot B. B dot A plus B dot B. This goes to 0. And B dot B will give me B. So, I'll get back and recover the component of B. So, this is the basic principle on which the CDMA works. So, you choose these codes such that they are orthogonal to one another. And once you have these orthogonal codes, then you can allow this transmission to take place simultaneously, but you can still recover each component individually. That's the beauty of the CDMA protocol. So, which the you can see how the whole thing works. That is, the entire channel is available for everybody to transmit. Right? That's the basic idea over here. Okay. Now, let me just go back to the... So, yes. So, we were talking about the CDMA protocol. So, I said, you must have got the idea by now. So, that is, we use multiple users to coexist and transmit simultaneously with minimal interference. We say minimal interference because even when you choose these codes, there could still be some amount of interference that can happen. And you need to have mechanisms of minimizing that interference. Okay. So, choice of the codes, that is very important in this case. So, this is the basis for the CDMA protocol. So, we have TDMA, which is time division multiplexing. Then you have frequency division multiplexing. Then we have code division multiplexing. Similarly, when we talk about optical channels, we talk about WDM, wavelength division multiplexing. That is, different wavelengths are allocated for different channels. Similar as a concept which is very similar to our frequency division multiplexing mechanism. Okay. So next, if we look at the random access protocols, these are very interesting protocols again, because here you are not dedicating dedicating the available bandwidth to any channel, but you allow all of them to share as and when a need arises. Okay, that's the beauty of these protocols. So, look at this here. So, what we want is, when a node has some packet to send, it should be able to transmit at the full channel data rate. Okay, that is R. Okay. So, no a priori coordination among the nodes. There is absolutely no coordination among the nodes. A priori. Okay, obviously, there has to be some kind of a coordination. What I mean by a priori coordination is that ahead of time, they have not arranged for any kind of a coordination. Okay. And so, what will happen now when two or more nodes transmit? When two or more nodes transmit, definitely a collision will occur. So, we need to have mechanisms by which you detect that a collision has occurred, and then you also have a mechanism by which you are able to recover from the collisions. That is what we need to do. Okay. So, let's look at how this is done in some of the standard protocols. There are many random access MAC protocols which are used. One of the first MAC protocols, random access MAC protocols, was the Aloha and the slotted Aloha protocols. It was one of the very first network itself that was set up, and that used this kind of a mechanism. The ones which are more common now, of course, are the CSMA, CSMA-CD and MACA protocols. Now, we will take a look at these protocols and see how they actually work. And basically, most of them have been derived from the Aloha, or the slotted Aloha, not Aloha, more of the Aloha kind of a protocol. So, let's look at how these protocols will basically work. So, we look at the CSMA protocol. CSMA stands for Carrier Sends Multiple Access. Now, what is important in most of these protocols that we talk about is that if you remember the acronym correctly and the expansion of that acronym correctly, you will mostly be able to find out what is the function that is being done by that particular protocol. Okay? So, when you say carrier sends multiple access, now we know that multiple access basically indicates that it is a multiple access protocol. That is, you have multiple nodes trying to access the channel, and we have to regulate who is going to access the channel. So, multiple access part, the meaning of that word should be clear. Okay, the other two words, carrier sense, what do we mean by that? This basically means that you first sense if there is any transmission. You sense the carrier. The carrier is the media where data is being transmitted. Right? You first sense the media, sense the carrier, check if there is any transmission in progress, right? So, you're looking at, what we say is you listen before you transmit. So, before we transmit, you listen. You check whether there is any transmission in progress. If there is a transmission in progress, obviously, if you transmit at that time, there will be a collision. So, you will refrain from transmission, right? So, you will not transmit your data. So, if the channel is sensed idle, then you will transmit the entire frame. But if the channel is sensed busy, if the channel is busy, what do we do then? Then we defer the transmission, okay? A simple analogy for this in terms of how we normally do our conversation is that you don't interrupt others. If you are in a room, many people are talking at the same time, obviously, data will be lost. So, what do we normally do? You always wait for your turn, or when somebody else is talking, you don't interrupt them. You wait until they have finished talking. Only then you start talking. Okay. So, when somebody is talking, you don't talk. That's the basic protocol that CSMA uses. So look at what happens in a CSMA situation, what in terms of how a collision actually would happen. Okay. Now look at how collision can happen. Now we talked about, we said anyway you transfer data only when nobody else is transferring data. So obviously I am listening to the media, seeing that the media is free and then beginning transmission. So in that case, the question you can ask is, how is it that a collision will occur? Right? This is a question that you can easily ask. We'll see how a collision can occur still. That is, in spite of the fact that you listen to the media, you check whether the media is busy or free before you do the transmission. Okay? So let's look at this picture here. Okay? So I've got these, let's assume that this is what I have here, A, B, C, D are four nodes which are located on a link at that particular space interval, at this particular distance. Okay? I have A, then I have B after some space, after some distance, then C and then D. Okay? So let's say I have this. Now let's look at B and D transmitting data. Okay? On the y-axis here, I'm showing time going ahead as I move down on this particular axis. So if you look at this, at time T0, let's say B begins its transmission. The yellow color transmission is that of B. Okay? And similarly, the red color's transmission, let's say, is that of D. Okay? So now, B begins its transmission. Now, the transmission of B, the moment it starts transferring data, that signal has to propagate and move and go to the other nodes which are there in the network, right? Or you have a particular link. Remember, we talked about whenever a signal has to go, it has to propagate, right? So we always talked about something called a propagation delay, if you remember. Propagation delay is the time that it takes for a signal to go from one place to another place. It will depend on the speed at which the signal is moving and also the distance. Okay, so it will take, let's say, for instance, some time before it reaches A. Right, A is here. Take some time before you reach A. So from B, this transmission that is there, by the time it reaches A, it takes up so much of time. Okay, this starts at T0. So similarly, if you look at D, okay, before it reaches D, it takes up so much of time. Okay, the signal from B will reach D only at this point of time. It started transmission at T0, but it will reach D at this point of time. So obviously you can see what will happen here. If D or C sends the channel before the signal from B reach them, okay, so when is it reaching? Reaching here, it is reaching somewhere here. So if D senses the channel around this point, which I am calling as T1, it will actually find that the media is free. There is no signal that is being transmitted in the channel. So what is it that D will assume based on the algorithm that we were looking at? It will assume that the channel is free, so it can start the transmission. So it will start transmission at time T1. So you will find that from T1 to whatever some amount of time, no collisions will be detected. But after some point of time, T1's signal would have moved from here to here. T0's signal would have moved from, B signal, which started at T0, would have moved from here to here. Let's say we call this as some time T2. After T2, you will find that there is a collision that is occurring. You can see that the overlap of the red and yellow colors indicates that there is a collision of the transmission of B and D. Okay, so that is, though at the point at which they started transmission, they did not detect a collision. Actually, a collision has occurred. Why is the collision actually occurring? Because of the propagation delay. Because any signal will take a finite amount of time to propagate from one place to another, within this propagation delay, if I sense the channel, I will find that it is actually free and I will start transmitting, though actually it is busy. So now what will happen after some time, if you look at the channel, you will find that both B and D will detect that there is a collision. Okay? So once they detect a collision, then they have to take some corrective measures. This is what is likely to happen. Now what happens in this case during when a collision occurs? They have been already transmitting all their data. So the entire packet transmission time is wasted. So that is one of the disadvantages of this kind of a mechanism. So what will happen now if a collision occurs? Suppose B's transmission was meant for A. When A is picking up the data, it will get data which is garbled because it is getting some transmission of B as well as D. So it will not be able to recover the data of B or D separately from that. So A will get junk data, right? So naturally you know that something has gone wrong. Then you make use of a higher layer protocol or whatever which identifies that an error has occurred. And it will again ask for a retransmission and so on, right? So that is what needs to be done in this case. Okay. So now, so let's look at the explanation once again, right? Because we said that if the propagation time is much less than the transmission time, then all stations know that the transmission has started almost immediately. Okay. So let me just go back to the previous slide. You can see what's happening here. So I said that I am starting transmission at T0. And it takes some amount of time for this signal to reach over here. So let's say, for instance, that the propagation time that I have, okay, is a very small propagation time, which means within a very short time, this signal will reach everybody. If the propagation time is very short, then naturally what will happen, everybody will get to know immediately that there is already a transition in progress. So the chance for a collision to happen will be reduced. Okay, that is what we need to keep in mind. So if the propagation time is much less than the transmission time, what I mean by transmission time is the time for which a frame is being transmitted. All stations will know that a transmission has started almost immediately, in which case, naturally, they can always refrain from doing for their own transmissions. But a collision will occur if another user starts transmitting within the time it takes for the first bit to reach this user. Okay, that's what we mean by the propagation. That is, remember that when you're starting transmission, you're transmitting a certain number of n number of bits. The first bit will should reach the other user. Right? When the first bit reaches the other user, this is the propagation delay. The moment the first bit reaches there, a signal has come over there. So you'll naturally know that some transmission is already in progress. Okay? So this is how you handle, that is how you determine when a collision occurs. And so normally a collision is detected by waiting for the round trip time plus, of course, ACK contention. We'll come back to ACK contention a little later. Okay? That is normally what you do is, if there has been no collision, then you get back an acknowledgement from the other side as part of your protocol. So if there is, if you get back an ACK, it indicates that your transmission has been completed. But again, it is also possible that the acknowledgements which are transmitted can also have collided with some other data. In which case, we refer to what is called as ACK contention or collision of the ACK itself. So then you know that again something has gone wrong. So what you do is if you do not receive any ACK, then you will do a retransmission. This is what I said. This can be handled either at the CSMA protocol layer itself, or it can also be handled by a higher layer protocol. Okay. And the maximum utilization here will depend on the propagation time. There is a media length and the frame length. So longer frame and shorter propagation will give better utilization. You can see how this will happen very easily. That is, you're transmitting frames for a longer time. So naturally, and the propagation delays are shorter. So the propagation delay is short, the frames will reach quickly, right? And so the chance of a collision occurring will be reduced, and each station transmits for a long time. So naturally, you'll have a better utilization of the entire bandwidth that is there. Okay, this is what happens in the CSMA protocol. Now, as I said, in the CSMA protocol, the disadvantage is that if a collision occurs, that entire frame is lost. Okay, so what the CSMA CD protocol, which is an improvement on the CSMA protocol, tries to do is that it adds one more CD to it. That is, in addition to our CSMA that we had in the previous one, we also have a CD. Now look at what we mean by this CD. CD stands for collision detection. CSMA has the same meaning. That is, carrier sense multiple access. Plus, we also have this collision detection which is added to it. Now look at what we mean by this. That is, as in the case of the CSMA protocol, we will again sense the carrier before we begin transmission. So carrier sensing will occur. Okay. As in the case of the CSMA protocol, but in addition to that, we will detect a collision as soon as it occurs. What I mean by as soon as it occurs is, within a very short time of a collision, you detect the collision, and the moment you detect a collision, you abort the transmission. Now, this is where we are trying to save the time that would normally take for transmission, for when you have a collision. Okay? In case of CSMA, what happened was, as soon as the collision is detected, we don't take any action. We just keep on transmitting and wait for an acknowledgement to come back from the other side when the full transmission is over. Only if we don't get an acknowledgement, we assume that, okay, a collision must have occurred, and then you may do a retransmission. Okay? So here instead what we do is, you sense the media, see if the media is free. If the media is free, you transmit data. If two people have sensed the media to be free at the same time, both of them would have simultaneously transmitted the data and a collision would have occurred. But the moment a collision occurs, both of them will immediately detect that a collision has occurred, and as soon as they detect that a collision has occurred, what they will do is they will try to stop the transmission. Okay, let's see how that is done. The moment they're already transmitting data, they immediately stop the transmission. If they stop the transmission, then naturally what happens, you're not unnecessarily wasting the bandwidth by transmitting data that is going to be of no use to anyone because it will be lost anyway, right? So you don't continue your transmission, stop your transmission. So you reduce the channel wastage by doing this. Okay. And this kind of a collision detection is very easy in a wired LAN. Okay, how do we detect these collisions? Typically, what we do is we measure the signal strength. Okay, as we said that example, B was transmitting and D was transmitting. Naturally, when both B and D transmit, the strength of the signal that you have will be higher. So all you do is you transmit and you keep looking at your receiver. You also monitor the received signal strength. When you monitor the received signal strength, you compare the transmitted and the received signals. When you find the signal strength is higher than what you are transmitting, naturally it means that there is some other transmission also in progress, which is indicative of a collision. So you detect the collision, okay, and then of course we can recover from the collision. Okay? Now, but in a wireless LAN, it becomes very difficult, okay, because normally what happens is the receiver shuts off while transmitting. This is a problem that you could have. And you'll also see how in wireless LANs there are certain additional problems also which crop up because of the nature of the media. Okay, so just to give you an example of the CSMACD, the collision detection mechanism, the same situation as we saw in the previous case. The same example I'm taking. So the interpretation of the figure is the same. I have A, B, C, D, the four nodes transmitting, which are likely to transmit. Time goes down as I go from here. B starts transmission at time T0. D starts transmission at time T1. Note that by the time at time T1, B's transmission has not reached D. Therefore, at T1, it finds that the media is free, so it can go ahead and transmit. So when it transmits data, you can see that within a short time, by the time B's transmission reaches over here, D detects that. And the moment it detects transmission, within a short time, it just stops the transmission. You can see that the red color ends over here. It does not continue its transmission. Okay, it stops the transmission. Similarly, B also, the moment B detects the collision, when will B detect the collision? When D's signal comes over to B. So let's say that happens at this particular point of time. Okay, at this particular point of time. And within this short time, B also stops the transmission. So you can see that instead of the full frame being continuously transmitted, you stop transmission over here and you have detected and you have reduced the time that is wasted on the network. Okay, that's the advantage of our CSMA CD mechanism. Okay. With CSMA, just to give you a comparison of these two, with CSMA, a collision occupies the medium for the duration of the entire transmission. That is, even if the station next to transmission station collided, collision will be detected only after a round trip time. That is, after data has gone from here to there and you get back an acknowledgement. Whereas here, with collision detection, the stations listen while transmitting data. If the medium is idle, then they transmit. If busy, they listen for idle, then they transmit. And if collision is detected, then they jam the transmission. What they do is they send a noise channel, and which will indicate to everybody that a collision has occurred so that nobody tries to recover the data, and then they stop the transmission. Okay? This is how this particular thing is handled. Okay. Now, after jamming, this is another very important aspect. After jam, now what happens? If you again, you will have to try to retransmit. Now, look at what can happen again. Again, both of them can sense the channel. Both of them will find that A and B are, both A and B, or let's say in this case B and D, will find that the channel is empty. No, that it is not busy. So both of them will again try to retransmit. Again, if they try to retransmit at the same time, the same situation can occur. Again, you can have a collision. So what is normally done is, they normally wait for a random amount of time before they begin the transmission. Okay? So that is, they don't transmit immediately, but they check the availability of the channel after a random amount of time. So if B chooses a different random value and D chooses a different random value, you will naturally find that the chance of a collision can be reduced. Okay, so particularly it uses something called a binary exponential backoff. Now let's see why do we need this binary exponential backoff? Let me quickly recollect what I was talking about. We have this CSMA CD mechanism, that is carrier sense multiple access with collision detection. Okay, so what is happening here, as we said, is a channel before it transmits will sense the a node before it transmits will sense the channel. And when it finds it that it is free, it will begin its transmission. Now, if another channel also had sensed the channel at this, another node had sensed the channel at the same time, it will also find that the channel is free. Or if it had sensed the channel a little time after this had started transmission, that is the time which is less than the propagation delay, it will again find that the channel is free and it will begin its transmission. Now, naturally, both the signals will collide and a collision occurs. If a collision occurs, we said, they will just send a jamming sequence to inform everybody that a collision has occurred and they will stop their transmission. If they have stopped their transmission, obviously they have to resume the transmission. That is, they have to now retransmit. So when do they do the retransmission? Naturally, as soon as they stop transmission, if both of them immediately come back and start doing their transmission again, naturally again a collision will occur. So collisions will keep occurring. And look at the scenario when more number of nodes are there and all of them want to transmit. So more and more collisions will occur and no effective data transfer will take place. So obviously we would like to avoid them. So we use this mechanism called the exponential back off mechanism. Okay. So an exponential back off, what is happening is that when two nodes have detected a collision, they just wait for a random amount of time. So let's say they will wait for a small time slot before they will do the retransmission. Okay. Now there are this time slot that is chosen normally is taken to be the time that it takes to transmit the smallest sized frame. Okay. Now the frame need not be of fixed size. The frame could be of different size depending on how much of data is being carried in it. But normally, as the CSMA/CD protocol is used in the IEEE 802.3 standard or the Ethernet mechanism, in that particular standard, okay, the minimum size of an Ethernet frame is supposed to be 64 bytes. So you can look at the time taken to transmit 64 bytes as the minimum frame size. So what do they normally do is they will measure time in terms of this minimum frame size. Let's call it as a time slot. Okay, let's assume that we call this the smallest frame size is a time slot. So what the channel will do, the moment it has detected a collision, is it first chooses a value between 0 and 1, let's say. What do you mean by 0 and 1? If it chooses a value of 0, it means it will transmit immediately. If it chooses a value of 1, it means it will transmit after one time slot. That is, it will try to sense the channel after one time slot. So when do they come back and try to sense the channel? That is determined after backing off for a random amount of time. So you back off, don't transmit, back off, come back and check the channel. When do you come back and check the channel? You wait for random amounts of time. So naturally what happens, if A chooses a different random value and B chooses a different random value, naturally chance of a collision will be less. But again, if both of them choose the same random value, a collision can occur. Okay. So if you look at how this typically will happen, okay, let me just, this is back to my, okay, so let's say for instance, I have my A, node A here, we had node B here, node C here and D transmitting, okay. So now B and D have transmitted data and both have detected a collision. So now both of them, let's say at some point of time T2, have decided that a collision has occurred and they're going to go into the back off state. So when they back off, right, so what is it that they will do? Let's say I said B will choose a value between 0 and 1, D also chooses a value between 0 and 1. What I mean by 0 and 1 is, if B chooses a value of 0, it transmits, it looks for the channel immediately, okay? Whereas if it chooses a value of 1, it will transmit, it will look for the channel, whether it is free, after one time slot. Let me call the time as tau, or let me call it as TF, okay? TF is the time taken to transmit a minimum sized frame, okay? Or TMF, to make it easier, okay? TMF is the time taken to transmit a minimum sized frame, okay? So now, okay, again, to make it easier, I'll note it by a capital T. So I either transmit immediately or I transmit after 1 into T times. Same thing D also can do. So now B chooses a value between 0 and 1. D chooses a value between 0 and 1. Now what is the probability that B chooses a value of 0 or 1? Actually, there are only two values. The probability that it chooses 0 or chooses 1 is half. Right? This is the probability of choosing 0 or 1. Similarly, probability of D choosing 0 or 1, okay, probability of 0, choosing 0 is half. Similarly, probability of choosing 1 is also half. Right? So, when will a collision occur? A collision will again occur if B chooses 0 and D chooses 0, or if B chooses 1 and D chooses 1. Okay? Collision will occur if, what is the probability of this collision now? Probability of the collision is the probability that B chooses 0 and probability that A chooses 0, right, plus probability that, B and D, not A, D chooses 0 and probability that D chooses 1 and probability that D chooses 1. B chooses 1 and D chooses 1. B is choosing a 0 and D is choosing a 0, or B is choosing a 1 and D is choosing a 1. So what is the value of this probability? You can see what is happening here. Probability of B equal to 0 is half. So you have half into half plus another half into half. So half into half is 1 by 4 plus half into half 1 by 4. So 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4, this probability becomes half. That is, the probability that immediately after a collision will again occur is half. So naturally now what happens? Again, if a collision occurs, look at what will happen. Again, now they will both detect that a collision has occurred and both will back off. Now, the second time that they back off, again, if they do the same thing of choosing between only two values of 0 and 1, you will find that more number of collisions can occur. So what they do second time is, if a collision has occurred once already, now they will double this values that they have over here. That is, instead of choosing value between 0 and 1, I will choose values between 0, 1, 2 and 3. This means I just either transmit after 0 times t, which is immediate, or after 1t, or after 2t, or after 3t. So my choosing of these four values is again done randomly. That is, now look at the probability that I will choose a value of 0 or 1 or 2 or 3. Four values to be chosen. I choose one of these values. The probability of doing this will be 1 by 4. So 1 by 4 is the probability of choosing these values. Similarly, D also now will choose between value of 0, 1, 2 and 3. So probability of choosing each of these values is 1 by 4. Okay. Again, look at the chance for a collision to occur. Now, when will a collision occur here? If both of them choose the same value. That is, if B chooses a value of 0 and D chooses a value of 0. Or B chooses a value of 1, D chooses a value of 1. B chooses a value of 2, D chooses a value of 2. B chooses a value of 3 and D chooses a value of 3. Then a collision will occur. Otherwise, a collision will not occur. That's because if, let's say, B chose a value of 1 and D chose a value of 3. Now what will happen? Because B chose a value of 1, after 1t, right, B will come and sense the channel. It will find that the channel is free. So it will start its transmission. Now D will come and sense the channel only after 3t. Okay? Because sensing only at 3t, naturally by that time, this transmission from B would have reached D. So when it senses the channel at 3t, it will find the channel is busy. Somebody is already transmitting data. So naturally it will not transmit data. And if it does not transmit data, no collision will occur. Okay? So we are trying to reduce the collision. But again, as I said, collision can still occur. What is the probability of that collision occurring again? Collision occurs, as we said, if B chooses 0, D chooses 0. So what is the probability of that event? It will now be, probability that B chooses 0 is 1 by 4. D chooses 0 is 1 by 4. So 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Right? Plus, again, same thing for 1. B chooses 1 and D chooses 1. 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Right? Similarly, D chooses 2 and B chooses 3. So you can say 1 by 4 into 1 by 4 into 4. Right? This is what will be the probability. That is, the probability now becomes, you can cut out these two. You get 1 by 4 into 1 by 4, which is 1 by 4. Okay? So probability of a collision, you can see now, becomes half of the probability of a collision in the previous case. What is the probability of collision over here? It was half. Now it becomes 1 by 4. Again, if a collision occurs, when will a collision occur? It will happen when B chooses a value of 0 and D chooses a value of 0, or these four cases that we saw. In that case, both of them will again detect a collision. Now, naturally, they will again back off. That is, they will stop the transmission, detect the collision, stop transmission and back off. Now, when they back off, they will back off even longer. That is, they will choose a value now not between 0 and 3, but they will use twice this amount of value. That is, they will choose values now between 0 to 7. Here they are choosing between 4 values. Now they choose between 8 values. So you will find the probability that a collision occurs will again be reduced to 1 by 8. So which is why we call this exponential back off. That is, you are backing off. The time, what do you mean by back off is, you back off, don't transmit, come back and try after some time. So the time after which you are going to come back and try at a random, okay, that value is increased as more and more collisions occur. Naturally what we are trying to do is, you are trying to reduce the number of collisions and allow transmissions to take place. Okay, this is a very important aspect of the of these Ethernet kind of protocols. Okay, the back off kind of mechanism. Now, I said that a minimum frame size is normally chosen. That is what we call as our T. Right. So now, what we normally do is, this T is always chosen such that, okay, I said it is, in the case of Ethernet, it is about 64 bytes. This T is actually chosen such that this T will always be greater than the propagation delay, which means that by the time I transmit a frame, okay, and this frame reaches the other end, right, the other end, that is, propagation delay is there, right, it has to go and reach the other end. By the time it reaches the other end, the transmission should not stop, it should not be over, because then in which case, if there is a collision, it will not be detected by B. That is, B is transmitting, D is receiving it. then D starts transmission and B is receiving. If the frame is very short, by the time B signal reaches D, okay, let's say for instance, by the time it reaches D, D did not know that the signal is, that there's a signal, so D would have started transmission. Now D signal will reach B, right? Only then B will detect the collision. Before D's signal reaches B, if B has finished its transmission, okay, the frame is so small that it finished the transmission, then what will happen? B will find there is no collision because as far as B is concerned, it has a very short frame, it sent that frame. And by the time that frame reached the other side, actually a collision occurred over there, but this fellow could not detect the collision. Now that scenario we do not want to have. If a collision occurs, we would like all parties to know that a collision has occurred, which is why we also make sure that there is a minimum size for the frame that is transmitted. The frame size is chosen such that if there is any transmission at the other end, by the time I get back the response from there to here, right, this starts transmission and that transmits after some time, and the propagation delay that I have for the signal to come from one end to the other end, okay, that my frame transmission time must be greater than that maximum propagation delay that I can have. Okay, that is how we choose this value of t. So that is why we can say that this exponential backoff scheme will also work, because our time slots are all chosen in terms of this t. So if I choose, if B chooses 1t and D chooses 2t, at 2t when it senses the channel, definitely you can be sure that this the first bit of here would have reached over there, because it's going to sense it only after time t, and time t is greater than the propagation delay. Therefore B's bit would have definitely reached D. So when B senses the channel at 2t, if B has started transmission at 1t, you will find that definitely D will detect the transmission. Okay, so that is how the exponential backoff mechanism works in the Ethernet protocol. This is a very important aspect of the CSMA/CD protocol, which is used in the Ethernet mechanism. Okay, now, all right. Oops. Barla. Okay. So that is our binary exponential backoff mechanism. It's called binary exponential backoff because you do it in terms of it's all in powers of 2. Okay, so that's the reason why it's called as a binary exponential backoff mechanism. Exponent goes in powers of 2. Now, as I said, this is used in the 802.3 standard, which is the Ethernet protocol. So now let's look at some details about the 802.3 Ethernet protocol. Basically, to understand what is our Ethernet protocol, because the most commonly used LAN technology, right? So the most so we need to understand how it basically works. In terms of the media access control mechanism which is used, it just uses CSMA/CD. So all the discussion that we had so far on carrier sense, multiple access with collision detection, that mechanism is what is used by the Ethernet protocol to share the media that is available. And what is the media that is normally used? We have actually two different types of connections that are used. Either we use coaxial cable or we use twisted pair kind of configurations. Okay. So when you have these coaxial cables, like you have a You know the difference between a coaxial cable and a twisted pair, right? So coaxial cable is something similar to your TV cable. Twisted pair, you can say, similar to the telephone cable. So when you use a coaxial cable, this coaxial cable, by means of connectors, you have a single cable which is running all through, and you will have different nodes connected to this cable. So this is single cable shared by all of them. Okay, so that is how the coaxial cable will work. Twisted pair has slightly different configuration. I'll tell you that shortly. Okay. And typical data rates that you have on the Ethernet vary from 10 Mbps, which is how Ethernet started. Then you have what is called fast Ethernet, which is 100 Mbps. Then you have gigabit Ethernet, which is 1 gigabit. And now we have tens of gigabit per second, which is also coming up on the Ethernet protocol. Okay. And at the physical layer, right, in terms of how the data is actually encoded, it uses the Manchester encoding. Remember, when we talked about physical layer properties, we talked about how data will be encoded. So there I talked about different types of encoding. So Manchester encoding was something that we looked at in that case. This Ethernet protocol uses the Manchester encoding. Okay. All right. So if you look at the 802.3's frame format, how the frame actually is organized. Remember that framing and other things are part of our data link layer, right? So when you talk of the MAC protocol, this MAC protocol along with the data link layer, all these things, they all come together, bundled up together. Okay. So we need to understand how the frame format is organized. So you look at the frame format. Normally what you have is before the frame begins, at the beginning of the frame, there is something called a starting delimiter, a special pattern which indicates that some data is being transmitted. Okay, so that this is used by the different receivers to synchronize and identify that, okay, now a frame is coming, let me get ready to receive the data. Okay, starting delimiter is followed by the destination address. Ethernet addresses are all 48 bits, 6 bytes wide. Okay. Destination address, which is followed by the source address. Then you have a length field, a 2-byte length field, which tells you what is the length of the data that is being carried in this particular frame. This is followed by the actual data. This data may have some logical in the link layer control header and plus the information feed. It can vary from 46 bytes to 1500 bytes. Okay, that is, and the length of this is specified over here. Okay. Then this is followed by a frame check sequence. A frame check sequence essentially is a error detection mechanism, and the that is, it is a sequence which is used to check whether there is an error in the frame, to check the frame. Okay, and the frame check sequence that is used in the case of Ethernet is our CRC protocol. The CRC error detection mechanism is what is used. It uses a 32-bit CRC. What do we mean by 32-bit CRC? Remember, we talked about in case of CRC, we said there will be a particular bit pattern with which you will divide the entire data bits, right? So that pattern with which we divide, that's a 32-bit pattern that is used. A CRC, so we say it's a 32-bit CRC which is used. So we use a 32-bit CRC which is used to detect errors in the frame that is being transmitted. Now, in the 802.3 frame format, there actually is a variation of this 802.3 frame format, which is sometimes referred to as the version 2 of the Ethernet frame format. So here what happens is everything else remains the same except this length field. There is no length field that is used. Instead, there's a type field which indicates what is the type of indicates what is the higher layer protocol to which this 802.3 data must be sent. That is, what kind of data is being carried in this 802.3 frame format. That is specified by this type field. Okay? So, you will find variations of these two. Sometimes you will talk about, you will see that a length field is used. Sometimes you will find that a type field is used. You must be aware of which format is being referred to. Otherwise, you can see that most of the other fields are pretty much, are all the same. And purpose of all the fields, you can very easily find out now. So, starting delimiter, we said, is used to identify when a particular frame begins. Okay, that is, that we need. So, it basically used for synchronization purposes. All of them must be able to receive the frame correctly. Okay, that is the purpose of the starting delimiter. They use this to synchronize their clocks so that they can receive the data correctly. Then we have the destination address and the source address. Now, these two are important because now there are multiple nodes which are sharing the link. You need to know who is to receive this frame and who is the person who is sending the frame. So, destination address is something which is used by each node. Each node obviously has its own address. So, it compares this destination address value with its address and sees if the two match. If the two match, then it is going to pick up the data. Otherwise, it need not pick up the data. Since it is a broadcast channel, everybody listens to all the frames and they will pick up the frame only if the destination address matches their value. Source address is an indication for me as to where the frame is coming from. Length field, we will see what length is. This is the actual data field that you have. And then we have the CRC which is used to do error control. Okay, so this is the meaning of the various fields that we have in the Ethernet protocol. Okay. with respect to the physical layer, in terms of how physically an Ethernet frame is organized, if you look at that, normally what happens is you can set up an Ethernet network over a particular given distance or a given area. Okay, but if you want to have an Ethernet network spread out across longer distances, there is I want it to become, to be spread out over a larger area, for instance. Then what happens is that we have to see if this distance has any, poses any limitation on how the network actually works. That is how the physical signals actually propagate. So what we'll normally find, this is a property of all electrical signals in general, is that the signal becomes weaker as it travels. That is, as it goes for longer and longer distances, it will become very weak. So now, naturally, if the signal becomes too weak, and you have a long distance that it has to travel, at the end, the receiver over there may not even be able to pick up the signal. Okay? If not able to pick up the signal, then naturally, our data transfer is not going to take place effectively. Okay? So, normally you have some limitation on the length of the data that can be used. So, if I want to extend it beyond a length, then what do I do? Then what we use is, we use devices called repeaters. Okay? This is something which is used at the physical layer. Okay? Now, what is a repeater? A repeater typically helps us to join different LANs together. What's this repeater? It's something like some electronic device which is continuously monitoring the electrical signals which are coming in on the LAN, and it transmits an amplified copy or a regenerated copy of the signal on the other side. That is, if I have a LAN A over here, okay, I have a LAN A here and I have a LAN B over here, okay, and there's a repeater sitting in between. You may not be able to see that link between these two, there's actually a link between this and this and a link between this and this. So this LAN is connected by means of this repeater to this LAN over here. Now naturally what happens is any signal which is received over here when it comes to the repeater is amplified and sent on the other side. In the absence of the repeater, it will not be able, you cannot have this whole thing as a single LAN, because you will find that the signal quality deteriorates, the strength of the signal deteriorates so much that you will not be able to reach the other side. So, the presence of the repeater helps us to extend these the LAN as such. Okay, this is something which is used. Okay. Then, this is the normal concept of repeater which is used with respect to any physical layer. But when we talk of Ethernet, we normally use the term hubs. Okay, now, so we need to know, you must have heard of this term Ethernet hub or an Ethernet switch that is used. So, we will understand what these things actually mean. Okay. The reason I am talking about these is that these are all very practical issues that you will actually face when you are using any network or setting up any network. So, we should understand what these things mean. Okay. So, what is a hub? A hub typically joins multiple input lines electrically. Okay. Again, this is also very similar to that doing a job which is very similar to that of a repeater, except that normally there is no necessary to need not maybe really amplify the signal, but it takes the data which is coming in on one end and sends it across to all the others. Okay, again, I'm not sure you're getting the picture right. Okay, so I have shown something like a hub over here. Okay, there's a hub here, and there's a hub here, there's a hub here, and a hub here. Okay, these hubs are connected to one another, right? That is, these three hubs at the lower layer are connected to this top hub over there, and each hub is connected to multiple computers, let's say, okay, multiple nodes. So, these nodes are connected by means of this hub, these nodes to this hub, these nodes to this hub, and these hubs are again connected to one another. Essentially, the job of this hub is to make it appear as if all these nodes are all connected on a single Ethernet segment. Though we are using different point-to-point links, okay, they all appear as if they are on a single link. So, what is the job of the hub? The hub basically takes any data coming in on any one of these, from any one of these nodes. So, this hub, you can say, will have multiple ports. We talk about an 8-port hub, 16-port hub, 32-port hub, and so on. What are these ports? Ports are the, places where a connection can be made to some, through a cable to some other machine. Okay. So, I have, let's say, for instance, there are three ports over here. These three ports. So, what a hub basically does is, takes the data coming in on any port and transmits to the other ports. So, it will transmit, if there's data coming in from this node, it will transmit it to this node, and also to this hub to which it's connected. This hub now will transmit the data to this hub, which in turn will transmit it to all the others. Similarly, it will go to this hub, which in turn will transmit it to the other nodes. So, data transmitted by any node will reach all the nodes which are connected by means of a hub. How an Ethernet segment is Ethernet LAN is actually constructed using these point-to-point links. When these are used, this is where we construct these Ethernet LANs using twisted pair cables. So, typically the connection between the nodes and the hub happens by means of twisted pair cables. So, use twisted pair cables and connect them up together. Though they may not look like a bus configuration, they actually behave as if the whole thing is a broadcast transmission happening on a bus. So, you can look at this whole thing. Everything appears as if the whole thing is on a single bus. And this hub takes care of making sure that the data is sent to all the nodes which are interconnected over here. Okay, this is how the hubs are organized. Okay. But normally what happens is the repeaters and hubs, both of them have certain limitations, which is why we now talk about replacing these with Ethernet switches. Okay, so, we'll come to what we mean by that. Now, here what happens is that when we use these repeaters or hubs, the repeater or a hub basically just takes data coming in from one port and puts it out on all the other ports, right? So, when it does that, all these nodes which are connected across these different hubs, okay, all of them are on a single collision domain. What do you mean by this? Data transmission from any one of those nodes, this may be at one end, this may be at the other end. Both of them put together, they all sit on the same collision domain, which means data transmitted from this and data transmitted from this other end over here, if both happen at the same time, again a collision can occur. Though physical segments are different, right, they are only interconnected by means of a hub, still collision wise they all appear as if they are on the same network, so on the same domain. So, we say it has a single collision domain. Okay, so chances of collision obviously will be higher in this case. That's a problem. Okay. which is every bit is sent everywhere. So the aggregate throughput is also limited. So totally it is 10 megabit per second. If you say the 10 megabit per second is shared by everybody, okay, so the total aggregate throughput that you have will be limited. So for instance, if three departments each get 10 megabit per second independently and you have connected them by means of a hub, now what will happen is independently if they were, they would have each got 10 Mbps. Now all three put together must share the same single 10 Mbps because all of them are now appearing as if they are on the same network. So that is a problem with these. Second thing is, normally with hubs, you cannot support multiple LAN technologies. Okay, that is, it will not buffer the frames because every bit that is coming out is just being sent out on all the other nodes. Okay, that is a problem that we have. So you can't interconnect between different rates or formats. I can't have a 10 Mbps hub and a 100 Mbps thing sitting together on the same thing. They all have to be of the same data rates. Plus, we also have limitations on the maximum number of nodes and the maximum distances that you can have. That is, how many hubs can be interconnected like this. Okay? You normally find that you cannot go beyond 2500 meters as the end-to-end distance between on an Ethernet link. Okay? And you cannot also go more than about 4 or 5 nodes in terms of how many hubs you can cross before you reach a. So there is also a limitation in terms of number of nodes and number of hubs that can be interconnected. So what do we do in this case? So how do we handle this problem? If I really want to increase the number of nodes I want to connect, but not have a reduction in terms of either the throughput or increase of, and I don't want to have an increase in collision. If I want to avoid all these things, what is it that we do? So we use what is called as a bridge. Okay, what is this bridge? Bridge basically is a device which can be used to connect up two LANs. This is what we call it. It is used to extend LANs. So sometimes we call two LANs which are interconnected by means of a bridge as an extended LAN. Okay, you can look at this picture here. So this is one LAN, this is another LAN over here, and both these LANs are interconnected by means of this bridge. So with this, what happens is, look at what this job of this bridge is. What the bridge will do is, it will look at the data coming in on this particular LAN. It look at the destination address. See whether the destination address belongs to a node which is on this side. It is on the other side of the bridge. If it is on the other side, then it will take it from here and put it on that side. Otherwise, data from here to here will keep happening over here, get transferred on this node. And this LAN can again operate independently. That is, look at so if I have data transferring between this host to this host, at the same time, another data being transferred between this host to this host, this data transmission and this data transmission will not interfere with each other, because bridge will not unnecessarily take the frame and put it on that side. It will only take the frame from here and put it on that side if it knows that this node is actually sitting on the other side. Okay, so essentially what happens is, this becomes a different collision domain, this becomes a different collision domain. So you are separating out the collision domains so that each of them will get their own bandwidth and their own data rates. Okay, so that's the advantage of having a bridge. Now, when we talk of Ethernet, you must have heard of this term of switches. What is actually a switch? Switch is actually, essentially, it's a bridge, but just operating much faster. That's all. Okay? So, a switch is something which is used not just to connect two different LAN segments alone, but can also be used to connect individual computers. Okay? That is what we mean by an Ethernet switch. That is, we say the hub can be replaced by a switch, and you will say you will get faster transmission. Normally, you would have heard many people talking about, to make a network faster, you replace your hub by a switch. What do we mean by this? What it actually means is that you're going to take this hub which has so many ports, replace it with another device called a switch. But the job that the switch is doing is slightly different from what the hub is doing. Now, we said what the hub does is it takes data coming in from one thing and just transmits it to all the others. A switch will not do that. It will have a little more intelligence than that. Not chuma just take it and transfer it to everybody else. Instead, it will do the transfer only if the actual signal has to go from one node to another node. Okay, so you can see what will happen over here. There's a picture. Okay, I have a switch in between and I have four nodes A, B, C, and D. They're all connected by means of the switch. Now, what can happen here is, like a bridge, this can support concurrent communication. What do we mean by that? Host A can talk to C while B talks to D. This can happen at the same time. They're all part of the same network. But still, A can talk to C and B can talk to D at the same time. So that is, the full bandwidth of the network is available for both these transmissions. That is the that is something which is facilitated by means of the switch. Okay. So let's come here. All right. So if you look at the advantages that you have of using a switch, you will have dedicated access. That is, host has direct connection to the switch rather than a shared LAN connection. This is one advantage. Second is, you will find there is a full duplex connection. So each connection can send in both directions, host sending to switch and host receiving from switch. So complete bandwidth is available for both the for the entire set of nodes, and it completely avoids collisions, which is how you have a better effective use of the channel. That is the importance of the switch mechanism. Okay, so basically it provides some kind of a traffic isolation, and using that, only packets which need to be actually forwarded are forwarded. I'll just show you one picture and we can kind of stop with this. Okay, so you can see this. When I have a switch or a bridge over here, I can have multiple networks connected again by means of a hub to various things. So these, because you connect by means of hub, they are on one collision domain, this is on another collision domain, this is on another collision domain. The switch makes sure that these three are isolated. So this is the kind of configurations that we have with the switches. This is how the Ethernet switches and other things work. Okay, these are some advantages. I'll just skip this and move on to the other thing. Okay, so this is what we will be looking at in the starting with in the next class. The next class, we look at other IEEE 802 standards. We look at the 802.5 and the 802.11, and then we will move on to the next layer, which is the network layer.